Okay. So there is, coupled to this, a theory called modern money theory or modern monetary theory. The economic advisors of the two people on the right of this screen, there's some of them are from this modern monetary theory school. AOC was a econ major at school, right? She has a lot of econ courses, and we'll watch her doing some econ eventually. The modern monetary theory says a couple things. One, it says our theory of money was built in the commodity money age, not the fiat money age. And theory should change because we're in a fiat money age and not in a commodity money age. Okay? We showed you those pictures in an earlier video of John Taylor, who was here at UNLV, and I actually asked him what he thought about modern money theory because he had just testified to Congress, and one of the other people who had testified at that hearing was a modern money theory guy. And he said, it's not modern and it's not a theory. But other than that, he didn't think too much of it. Anyway, so them that's doesn't sound like it's completely off base, right? That maybe a fiat money system runs differently than a commodity money system. That's possible. It's also based on, in part, on the theories of a man named Hyman Minsky, who was a follower of Keynes. And we'll talk about Minsky some more. It's one of those deals where they use Minsky's name, but only the parts of his theory that they like. They don't use the parts of his theories that they don't like. Okay? And it's based on this idea that we have faith. We believe in our money. And as long, in their view, as long as we have that faith in our money, as long as we believe in our money, we can print lots of it without any economic consequences. Okay? They're going to say, for example, also that real low interest rates are zero. That's normal. That's the normal in a fiat money system, is to have interest rates down at zero, and there's nothing wrong with that. Okay? So you have very low interest rates in their mind all the time, and you can go ahead and print money as long as people in your country, as long as everybody in the country, and in fact in the world, believes in the US dollar, has faith in the dollar, then printing money doesn't cause inflation. You get inflation in countries where people are worried about their government. They don't really trust their government anyhow. And then when that government starts printing money, that's what causes the inflation. It's the combination of things, not just that you're printing money. It's the institutional structure that's around you printing this money. Okay? So they say, look, you're not going to get inflation. And an example of that would be this 2009 thing, where we added $3 trillion. The Fed put $3 trillion of new money into the economy, and we haven't had inflation. It's 10 years later. No inflation. Okay? Oh, wait, a short run, long run. What's the long run? Well, 10 years after it happened, we haven't had inflation. Okay? This theory also has an implicit theory behind it that the government should guarantee everyone a job. And they say, look, it's not really that expensive. It's not as expensive as you would think. Because people who don't have jobs now, they're getting government benefits. They're getting unemployment insurance, or they're getting SNAP and housing assistance and all these other government benefits. So if you take that money you're already spending on government benefits and you use it to put these people to work and you put them to work doing useful work for the government, it doesn't actually add that much to the size of the government budget. Okay? And again, you can this it it's not my job here. It's not our job to spend a long time on this, and you can go read up on this stuff if you want to. But the idea of the modern money guys is sitting out there, and it basically says that the big debts don't matter, that we can get those interest rates down to zero and basically not have to pay the debt off and not have to. Okay? And the only thing I'll say about that, I've said before, those our national debt, our government debt, if it pays a reasonable interest rate, is a safe place for normal people to put their money. My grandma put all her money always into savings bonds. And she, when my grandma passed, she had tens of thousands of dollars of U.S. government bonds, and she was getting good interest on them. Where does your grandma, who's got $100 a month to save, where does she put that money now that gives her a good return on her money, right? And if you believe the interest rate should be zero and government bond interest rate should be really close to zero, then, yeah, where's the safe place? But anyway, these things are complicated, right? There's always trade-offs, and there's no such thing as a free lunch. All right, just for comparison purposes, the national debt to GDP. In the United States, where are we? Let's go back. Let's go back to the graph in case you don't believe me. We're right around 100. And in fact, right now, GDP was a little over 20 and the debt's at 25. So we're pushing 120 now because of the problem that we just had in total. But remember that, so this is total public debt. Remember that the Federal Reserve owns a lot of that debt. Right? The Federal Reserve owns a lot of the debt. So things, you know, the Obama administration always used to say that the debt was 75% of GDP. And that's because they weren't counting the part of the debt that the Federal Reserve and other governmental entities owned. Anyway, we're a little over 100. Japan's at 225, Greece at 142, Ireland at 100. Right? So Japan's debt to GDP ratio is twice ours. And they haven't had any problems. On the other hand, Greece and Ireland have had horrible problems, and they're not much different than us. And Britain was headed toward a problem, even though they're not where we are. Okay? So it's not necessarily, you've got a whole complicated thing of the size of the debt and the income of the country and how trustworthy people think they are and all of that stuff.
Idle industries have cast workers into unemployment, human misery, and personal indignity. Those who do work are denied a fair return for their labor by a tax system which penalizes successful achievement and keeps us from maintaining full productivity.
Okay, that was Ronald Reagan's inaugural talking about the tax system and productivity and stuff. And in a lot of ways, I didn't think too much of President Reagan. I did interview him once. When I was a journalist, I actually sat down across a table from him and interviewed him. But how could you not like a president who does a graph during a speech? He did a graph. Look at the graph. He was an econ major in college. Drew a graph, showed a graph in a presidential address. How can you not like a president who draws a graph? Okay, so this graph is about the economy in the long run. So what's the long run issue? The long run issue in our economy is we need to move aggregate supply. The government, by changing its spending, directly affects aggregate demand. The government, by cutting taxes, thinks of itself as directly affecting aggregate demand. We need to affect aggregate supply in the long run. We need to be able to push aggregate supply out in the long run. That's how we make our economy grow in the long run, is by moving aggregate supply, not aggregate demand. But what our tax system does is it creates this thing called the wedge. And what the wedge means is your taxes go up faster than your income. So if I double your income, I more than double your taxes, and you don't take home double, you take home less than double. Okay? Now, Adam Smith thought that's the way the tax system should be. Warren Buffett thinks that's the way the tax system should be. Lots of people think that's the way the tax system should be. And, well, we'll talk here in a second. But Reagan's argument is that this wedge, and he didn't get it from him, he got it, but what happens is that discourages people from working hard. If you know that if you double your income, you get to keep less than the whole amount, that affects your willingness to work for that extra money. The Beatles, if you know who the Beatles were, Yeah. They have a song called Taxman. The Beatles, if you know, they all left England. And they left England because British government raised taxes. And they raised the marginal tax rate on millionaires to 95%. So when the Beatles would put out a song and they'd make an extra $1 million off of that song, they'd pay $950,000 in income tax and get to keep $50,000. Well, why would you put the song out? Why would you work? So they left the country. All four of the Beatles left England to escape the taxes in England. So England put those taxes on expecting their tax revenue to go up, and in fact their tax revenue went down because every rich person who could got out of the country, and the ones who couldn't get out of the country arranged for their income to get out of the country, and yeah, not good. Okay? England got a new prime minister, Margaret Thatcher. She lowered taxes. England boomed more. Okay? So that's Reagan's argument, that this is called supply-side theory. It's sometimes called Reaganomics. It comes mostly from a guy named Art Laffer. And it involves a couple things. One, it says cut taxes, particularly on the rich. Why? Well, you got to stimulate people to earn income and work harder. Middle class, lower income people, they're on a fixed salary. So cutting their taxes doesn't stimulate anything because it actually gets them more money and there's no reason for them to work harder. So you cut taxes on the rich. Mitt Romney, who was running for president against Obama in 2012, didn't say cut taxes for the rich. He said cut taxes for the job creators. And when asked for his definition of a job creator, he said everybody who makes over $250,000 a year. Those people are the job creators. Okay, and again, I'm not telling you this is the truth. I'm telling you this particular argument. And if you think there's issues with that, then you can, right? Free speech. Free economics. Number two, the idea here was to simplify the tax system. Get rid of tax brackets. Just everybody pays, 18% or something. Okay? So that if you double your income, you get twice as much money to take home. Okay? And then couple that with deregulation. Get rid of rules and regulations in the economy that are getting in the way. And you should have an economic boom. All right? So Reagan does all this when he becomes president. We do, in fact, do pretty well economically, but Reagan almost triples the national debt, too, while he's president. So there's good sides and bad sides, and there's arguments to this day about whether that tax cut had anything to do with the boom. And some of the people who thought the tax cut was positive argue that it wasn't good in the 80s. It didn't really kick in until the 90s. And so you have, again, you have people who say, yes, that's why the 80s were so good, this tax cut. There are other people who say, didn't do anything. And then there's other people who say, it worked in the 90s. Okay. So if we agreed, this class would be no fun. But the thing you have to remember in this class is that, in macroeconomics at least, we economists don't agree about much of what's going on. So jobs by president, you can see that there were a lot of jobs created by Reagan who was president. He's the second biggest job creator of all time after, he cut taxes. Clinton raised taxes, and he created more jobs than Reagan did when he was president. And again, you can argue again about whether presidents have anything to do about job creation or not, but we seem to blame them when things go bad, so we ought to give them credit when things are good. So Clinton is the number one job creator of all time. Reagan's the number two in terms of actual jobs, not percentage, but actual jobs that are created. George W. Bush cut taxes. He did a Reagan kind of tax cut taxes for the rich. Hardly any jobs. Obama cut taxes for lower income people, not for rich people, but he kept the Bush tax cuts. He could have let the Bush tax cuts expire. He didn't. Kept them and then put in some other tax cuts. And Obama, there's a recession. When Obama takes office, we're in this recession. Okay? And the recession is, we're losing, a half a million to a million jobs a month when Obama took over. The last few months of the Bush administration were just bleeding jobs, and then Obama comes in and we're still bleeding a half a million to a million jobs a year. So Obama counts those first, you know, 5-6 months he was president as belonging to Bush, not to him. If you do that, then Obama created a whole bunch of jobs, and he's close to Reagan in terms of total number of jobs created as president. Trump, in his first term, there's no corona in here, right? His job numbers might actually be negative for being in the end, might actually be negative for his first term in office, which hasn't happened since Herbert Hoover at the start of the Great Depression. But this is where he was. If you take the first 3.5 years of him being president, and then you just push that forward, you know, kind of average it forward to 4 years, that's where he would have been. He was, for 3.5 years in as president, he was behind Obama's last three and a half years. So Trump's first 3.5 years created fewer jobs than Obama's last 3.5 years were created. Okay, the corona thing with the crisis we're in, he might end up even or negative. He might be like a Bush one there, or he could even be a minus. We don't know. We'll see. I'll have to update this lecture when we find out. So this is new jobs by year. You can see that 2008 and 2009 were not good years for job creation. And then every year since, Obama set the record his last 6 years as president. There was not a single month where jobs went down, where the total number of jobs in the economy went down. And, of course, that's been broken here in 2020, that string. But the U.S. economy went 8-ish years where every single month there were more jobs than the month before. And that's never happened in our history. So 6 years of Obama, 2 years of Trump, where we just had job growth every single month. Okay. Was that fun? We have one more set of videos to go.